Romans chapter 6. I want to carry you a little further into the sixth chapter, even before we get there, because this is another very difficult passage, evidently, for many people from the many different views that are given on this portion of Scripture. So what we'll do this evening, we'll look at this, and I'll try to raise some questions for you to be thinking about, because it is a very controversial verse of Scripture. I doubt that we'll get beyond the sixth verse. I'm talking about Romans 6:6. Keep in mind, we're not through with verses 3 through 5 yet. I'll be preaching more from those three verses this coming Lord's Day, the Lord willing. Subject of baptism. And now looking at verse 6. Let me read the verse, first of all, in the King James, and then I'll go back and read it again and give the translation. Not too many great changes. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified, notice now, is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, is the way the King James translates it, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Now, there are two things in this text that we must understand. And it is not as easy as you might think to come to a settled position on this. You'll have to do a lot of studying on your own. Even though I'll give you the different views, some of them tonight, I'll discuss them more when we do preach on it on the Lord's Day. Not this Sunday, I'm sure, but probably the next. I doubt we'll be able to get to it Sunday night. But I'll give you enough to be thinking about between now and the time that I do speak, and we'll be preaching at least one message just on this sixth verse. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him in order that the body of sin may be ineffective, that we no longer serve sin. Now, the two things I want you to look at in this text are, first of all, our old man. And secondly, the body of sin. Are they the same? No, they're not the same. Now, having said that, I want to give you some views on this and how they differ. So listen to these views. Some equate old man with the body of sin. I can't do that. I can't conscientiously do that. Don't believe that anyone else can. There are some who say that the old man and the old nature are the same. Some believe Paul used the word crucified rather than died, because the old man is still alive and flourishing. Now, I'm going to give you some quotations, just brief quotations. You don't have to copy these down because you have some of these books in your home library. I'll just run through to show you that it is a controversial verse of Scripture. And may I make this statement before I read these quotes? These men were not and are not heretics. Those who are living, they're not heretics. We have to be careful about just using the word heretic because we disagree with somebody on a particular point. Now, of course, some of these men have been dead for a long time. Matthew Poole, for instance. Here's what he says. Quote, by the old man is meant that corrupt and polluted nature which we derive from Adam. The body of sin is the very same that he is called before the old man. Hodge, quote, our old man, that is, our corrupt nature, as opposed to the new man, our holy nature. John Gill. By the old man is meant the corruption of nature, called a man. Albert Barnes. quote. Paul uses the expression to denote our sinful and corrupt nature. Spurgeon. Every new man is two men. No, he's not two men. I just couldn't help but say that at this point. I didn't intend to say anything, but it just came out. Some things, you know, when you read them, you have to follow up with something. You just can't be quiet. He is what he was and not what he was. Now, let me read this again by Spurgeon. Every man is two men. He is what he was and not what he was. He's what he was and not what he was. End of quote. Barnhouse. The old man is the biblical term for the Adamic nature with which we were born. It is wrong to convey the impression either that the old man has departed from us or that he remains with us but no longer affects us. Haldane. All believers died with Christ on the cross. Their old man or sinful nature was crucified with Christ. If then their old man has been crucified with him, it cannot be that they will for the future live according to their old nature. Williams and Williams' commentary. The old man, that is, the evil principle lodged in man as a son of the first Adam, the body of sin, that is, the invisible activities of that evil principle. End of quote. Now, we could just go on and on with these if we wanted to, but I wanted to show you that there's a lot of confusion about what this verse teaches by men who are and who were great Bible students. And we have to learn to accept that and appreciate what they said in many areas. But no man has all the truth. No one, period. No one. Let's look at this verse, and I want to take you to two other passages of Scripture, and you're going to think that there is some contradiction between these statements. Now, Paul is the only writer in the New Testament that uses the expression that you find here, our old man. And he uses it three different times. He gives it here in Romans 6:6. He uses the expression in Ephesians chapter 4, and we'll read that one in just a minute, and also in Colossians chapter 3. So turn with me now to Ephesians chapter 4. Let's read that passage first. Now, we're not going to discuss all these in detail tonight, folks. Hope you realize that. Ephesians 4. Let's begin with verse 22. I'm not going to read the King James first. I'll just give you the translation. That you put off, or you put off, you don't have to use that. You put off concerning the former. Well, let's go back up so we can get the proper connection. In verse 20, but you have not so learned Christ, if so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former way of living. Conversation can literally be translated way of living. The old man. Now here's a second time Paul uses this expression. The old man who is being corrupted according to the lusts of deceit, and to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Now notice the 24th verse. And you may think this rather strange. And that you put on the new man. Now, I want to show you something. There's nothing wrong with the use of the word man in verse 24, even though it is not in the Greek text. Let me call attention to that. Go back to verse 22 again. And you'll notice on the second line, the last three words, ton, palion, anthropon. And it's translated the old man, and that's true, the old man. So you have anthropon, that's the accusative for anthropos. However, in verse 24, when he talks about the new man, putting off now and putting on, that you put on the new man, if you look at your Greek for just a moment, yes, you do have it here. That's maybe in Colossians I'm thinking about. You have the new man, the and kainon, anthropon. So you have ton, kainon, and that's the word for new, and then anthropon. And to put on the new man according to, let me read my translation. And that you put on the new man who according to God has been created in righteousness and holiness of truth. Therefore, having put off the lie, speak every man truth with his neighbor, because we are members one of another. Now turn to Colossians chapter 3. I believe it is. And I think it begins with verse 9. Colossians 3, verse 9. Yes. Do not lie to one another, having put off the old man with his practices. Deeds, okay, but I like practices better. And having put on the new. Now here's what I had in mind. It was Colossians rather than Ephesians. I knew it was in here somewhere, but I had forgotten where. So let's read the ninth verse again and go right into the tenth, and I'll call attention to it. Do not lie to one another, having put off the old man with his practices, and having put on the new. You notice the word man in your King James, it's italicized. That means it has been supplied. Now stop there just a moment and look at your Greek text in verse 10. And having put on. Having put on is an aorist middle participle. And it's in the nominative case, masculine and plural number. And then he has ton, neon, ton. So he has just ton, neon. Now, neon is masculine. So since it is masculine, you can say man. But the word anthropon is not in the text, and that being the accusative of anthropos. So there's nothing wrong with using man. So I left man in the translation, just as it is in the King James. Even it is italicized. So, the 10th verse, and having put on the new man, which is being renewed for complete knowledge according to the image of the one who has created him. Now, so these are the only three places where the expression the old man is used. What does it mean? Let me go back to Romans chapter 6. Let me make a few comments, just brief comments tonight on this. And then I'll go into it more extensively in an outline that I have here that I will share some of the things with you at the present time. All right, let's put verses 6 and 7 together. And I'm doing this for a reason. Actually, these two verses need to be studied together. You can't hardly separate them. So let's read verse 6 again and go on and read verse 7 before we stop. Then I want to ask you a question about verse 7. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified. Was crucified. Now, why are we translating it like that? Was crucified is an aorist passive indicative. So when you have the passive voice, aorist mood, you translate it was. So was crucified with him in order that the body of sin may be ineffective, that we no longer serve sin. For the one who has died has been made free from sin, or has been freed from sin, or has been made free from sin. And it's better to say has been made free, because it is a perfect passive indicative. And you need that been in there for the passive voice. First of all, let's look at the two expressions that I call attention to. Are they the same or are they different? First of all, let us look at a very important word here. Look at the expression on the second line, the first three words. Palaios, hemon, anthropos. So, you have the old, our old man. Palaios means old or former. In some places you wouldn't translate it old, you would here, but you would translate it former. But former also tells you something. Now this is the unregenerate man. The old man is the unregenerate man. And we know that this expression is also used in Ephesians and Colossians, which we've also read. Now, crucified. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified. Where was the old man crucified? I'm asking you questions now. Put these down and think about it. Where was he crucified? Where was the old man crucified? And secondly, when was he crucified? So where and when? And what kind of death was it? What kind of death was it? Right, now the next expression, the body of sin. The body of sin. Used only here. This is the only place where this expression is used in the New Testament. The body of sin. What does it mean? I certainly do not believe it is the same as the old man. So, the body of sin used only here. But the principle of sin is resident in the body. The principle of sin is resident in the body. So the physical body is the vehicle through which the principle of sin operates, even in a renewed person, in a new man. Right? And we'll get into this in great length later on in the 6th chapter, and also when we come to the 7th chapter as well as the 8th chapter of Romans in dealing with the subject of sanctification. So you may put down here, so the principle of sin is resident in the body. Verse 14. Let's read verse 14. Well, let's look at these verses now to kind of amplify what we're talking about. For sin shall not have rule. It could be translated either rule or power. Rule over you or power over you. For you are not under law, but under grace. Then let's look at some other verses here in the 6th chapter. Look at verses 17 and 18. Verses 17 and 18. This will help us to understand what is meant here by this expression. But thanks to God that you were slaves of sin, that though you were slaves of sin, I think that needs to be thrown in, though you were, enables us to understand it better, you were the slaves of sin, and you obeyed out of the heart a pattern of teaching to which you were delivered. And having been freed, and that could be once for all, from sin, you were enslaved to righteousness. Now let's read two other verses. Drop down to verses 20 and 21. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free, that is, you were destitute, you were free from, or you were destitute of righteousness. Now we know that, don't we? We can certainly relate with that. We were destitute of righteousness. Then in verse 21, what fruit, therefore, were you having at that time relating to which things you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. Now let's go ahead and read on through the 23rd verse. But now, having been freed from sin, and having been enslaved to God, you have your fruit resulting in sanctification, and the goal, of course, being eternal life. And I'll tell you something that's really kind of clever in this. Well, let's read the next verse. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, there are several things, beginning with the 18th verse. What if I were to stand before you on the Lord's Day and I were to say, no one is free. No man is free. Would you think that is true or false? If I were to say that no one is free, you say, wait a minute now. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And verses would start coming to your mind. Does that contradict what I have just said? No one is free. No individual. Look at the 18th verse again. And having been freed from sin, you were enslaved to righteousness. As soon as you cease to be a slave of Satan, you become a slave of Jesus Christ. So no person is free. No person is free. So both, in other words, we're born a slave to sin, and then we're born again to being a slave for Christ. So when you're born, you're automatically a slave of sin. And when we're born again, we become a slave of Jesus Christ. I love the latter slavery, don't you? So having been freed, that's an aorist passive participle. You were enslaved, that's an aorist passive indicative. And the participle, of course, goes before the main verb. And the main verb is what? You're a slave. Now then, we have a twofold obligation. And that twofold obligation that is also brought out in the sixth chapter of Romans. Number one, we're to know what the Lord requires of us. That's our responsibility, to know. And secondly, to do what we know. And then when you look at verse 23, the last verse, there is no reduction in the wages of sin. No reduction. That's saying a lot in just a few words. No reduction in the wages of sin. But I want to show you a beautiful outline here, beginning with verse 16 through 22. First of all, there is a new obedience. Verse 16. We'll not go back now and read these verses. A new obedience. Verse 16. Secondly, there is a new power which enables us to obey, and that's verse 17. a new power, a new obedience, and then a new power in order that we may obey. And then thirdly, a new freedom in which we operate. That's verse 18. A new freedom. And number four, there is a new service that results in progressive sanctification. That's verse 19. And then number five, there is a new motive, and that's what promotes action, that not only results in progressive sanctification, but its destiny, watch this, its destiny is eternal life. Now let me show you a beautiful thought here. Drop down to verse 22 again. Look at verse 22. Read all of verse 22 with me. Let me make this comment before we go back and begin an outline on verse 6. In verse 22, but now having been freed from sin and having been enslaved to God. See, there it is. We're never without slavery. We're always a slave. Either the devil or slave of God. Everybody's a slave. That wouldn't go over very well today, would it? That's an absolute fact. So, but now having been freed from sin and having been enslaved to God, you have your fruit resulting in sanctification, that's progressive sanctification. And now look at the last words of verse 22. Telos, Dizon, Aionion. And it's translated in life eternal. END. Telos means end, but it also means other than just end. It can also mean consummation. Also mean fulfillment. So here's what I want to leave with you on this point. So it's wonderful to be able to experience eternal life before we experience eternal life in eternity. And here's the thought. So it's wonderful, just look at the word end as they translated it here in your interlinear. Telos, they translated it in. So it is wonderful that we have the end before we get there. Now think that through a moment. I said it's wonderful that we have the end before we get there. You see what I'm talking about? Let me state it differently, because I want to translate telos a little different. So thus we have the conclusion before it is concluded. We have the conclusion before it's concluded. See, the eternal life I have now is going to be concluded. It's not concluded yet. It's going to be greater in degree than I experience now. Because I'll be in my glorified body and other things. See, I'll be in a glorified environment and on and on and on. So, we have the conclusion before it is concluded. Now we'll go back to verse 6. And we'll spend the rest of our time tonight on verse 6, this so-called controversial verse. So the old man is the unregenerate man. That's the old man. So what man was in Adam is gone when he is regenerated. He's gone. He's dead. So reckon yourselves to be dead. You got to count it. You got to calculate it. You got to realize it. When did we die? At Calvary. Legal. Legal death. And then, of course, that was applied in regeneration. Now, we're in the subject of sanctification here. And since we're in the subject of sanctification, sanctification is not crucifying the old man. Now, that's the statement I want you to get. Crucifixion, you don't crucify the old man. I'm not crucifying the old man. He's dead. In my calculation, he's dead. And there's not any scripture here where we crucify the old man. We crucify the deeds of the body. Nothing stated about us crucifying the old man. The expression "the old man" only found three times. We've already looked at all three references. Now, this is the foundation truth in the Christian life. I said this is the foundation truth in Christian experience. So the history of the old man has been terminated in Christ's death. Crucifixion of the old man is something to be reckoned by faith or calculated or counted or... That's logizomai, very important verb. Logizomai. Now the believer is not commanded to crucify the old man. We don't find that expression in the scriptures. Look at verses 12 and 13. Turn to Romans 8 and look at verses 12 and 13. Still dealing with sanctification, but I wanted to make this point, and this is a good passage to read. Consequently, we are debtors not to the flesh. See the term that is used? Flesh. To be living according to flesh. For if you are living according to flesh, you will certainly die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, and that's the same as the body of sin. If you put to death the deeds of the body, if we don't crucify the old man, he's to be counted dead. When Paul said, I was crucified with Christ in Galatians 2:20, that's a perfect tense. I have been perfect passive indicative. I have been crucified with Christ. So the old man is dead. When did that take place? At Calvary. These things are so difficult for young Christians to understand. But you have to be able to make these distinctions or you'll just get yourself in a big mess and stay in it. I know I've been there. I've been there and trying to understand these things. You can imagine a young Christian without any training whatsoever, anyone to give any help. He starts reading Romans like 6 and 7 and 8 and he is so confused he doesn't know which end is up. Take study. All right, let me give some more points. I just want to give a bunch of points for us to be thinking about. So believers do not gradually die, as far as the old man is concerned. I said as far as the old man is concerned. So believers do not die to the old man. There is a gradual dying, don't get me wrong. But it is not to the old man. And to show you that we do gradually die, 2 Corinthians 4:10 through 12 and other passages, but that's a classic one. Now, this is very important. The believer is not two men. That's dualism. The believer is not two men. He's one man. But he has two natures. One man, two natures. So he's not two men. He's one man with two natures. The believer is a new man in Christ. A new man. Because he has been justified or declared just or set free. The old man has been crucified. Another statement, our old self was crucified with Christ. And that's in the aorist tense, which denotes a single and completed past act. So the aorist denotes a certain thing occurred once for all in past time. Now, those are some basic things. Now, when you think about some of the statements that I have made here, how do these statements stack up with some of these quotations that I gave? For instance, let's listen to them again. Who by the old man is meant that corrupt and polluted nature which we derive from Adam. The body of sin is the very same that he is called before the old man. So he takes the body of sin and equates it with the old man. You don't do that. That's confusion. I won't read any more because I've already read them. Let's go on to another point. So we have first of all looked at the old man, and the old man is the unregenerate man. Now let's think about the body of sin. Just giving you some basic things now about the body of sin. In other words, the body is the vehicle in which the principle of sin acts today in you and in me. It's where he dwells. When Paul said in Romans 7:18, let's look at that verse for a moment. Romans 7:18. We're not getting ahead of ourselves. We're just staying with the subject we're discussing. But we have to roam all over this that's dealing with practical and progressive sanctification. For I have known that in me, that is in my flesh, no good thing is dwelling. For to desire is present to me, but to accomplish the good I do not. So the body is the vehicle. The physical body in which the instrument of sin or the principle of sin resides and operates. Now, the person of the believer is legally free. The person. This is a very important point. The person of the believer is legally free from sin. But his body is not free from the effects of sin and the fall. That's why we die. And the Lord tears us coming, we're going to all die. That's why we sin. Now, having said that, I want to show you a point here, and I'm not getting too far ahead of myself. Let me call your attention to something and see if you catch it. Look at Romans 6, verse 1 for a moment. All I'm going to do is to read this without emphasizing, hopefully, if I can, and then I'll read another verse and get you to ask, and I'll ask you to ask yourself a question. What then shall we say? May we continue in sin? Now look at the word. The verb is a present active subjunctive. Present tense, active voice, subjunctive mood. First step away from reality, you remember. And we won't get into that tonight any further than having made that statement. Present active subjunctive. So you can translate it like this. May we continue in sin that grace may abound. So continuing in sin, present. Present active. Now, I told you last Sunday that the 15th verse gives the beginning of the second major division of chapter 6. What then? Same terminology, same Greek. Now notice this. Instead of it being a present active subjunctive, what do we have in verse 15? we have an aorist active subjunctive. Now, what's the difference between verse 1 and verse 15? One is a present active subjunctive. The second one is an aorist active subjunctive. Now, what do we have? In simplicity, what is it that really stands out in your thinking that we have just stated? You want me to go ahead and say it? In the present active subjunctive of verse 1, that's in harmony with how Paul is beginning this chapter on progressive sanctification. And in answering the last two verses of chapter 5. So we have the present active, which means continue in sin. How then can we continue in sin? All right. But when we come to the 15th verse, we're in another division now. And so we have an aorist active subjunctive in verse 15. And this refers to single acts of sin. Not a continually living in sin, but acts of sin which we all commit. But there's a difference in living in sin and committing acts of sin. Christians commit acts of sin, but they don't live in sin. Don't live in sin. So that's the difference, because we're going to the second division of the chapter. So distinction must be made between the personality of the Christian and his body. Still making distinction between the old man and the body of sin. In verse 6. Now, sin does not reign over the personality of a Christian. Sin does not reign, and that's all brought out in this sixth chapter before we get through, does not reign over the personality. But it does seek, sin, the principle of sin in you and in me, does seek to dominate the body. So the word flesh in this sixth chapter could really be equated with the term body in this sense. Sarx, it can refer to the body, human body. And keep in mind, the word sarx is used about as many different ways as the word sozo. That'll keep you busy for a while. Now, regenerate men, though not under dominion of sin, have the presence of indwelling sin, with which we must reckon all the days of our lives on this earth. So I can't hope that the time will come in my physical life here that I won't have the conflict. I'm going to have it. In fact, it's going to increase. The more you know about truth, the greater the warfare. You say, well, I'm just going to stay dumb and not go any further. You can't do it. You can't do it. Period. So the body in itself is not inherently sinful. I'm talking about the body now. The body itself is not in itself inherently sinful. But the body with its various members and instincts are subject to temptations and sin. The believer himself is delivered, but his body is not delivered. I'm delivered, and yet I'm not delivered. See, that sounds like a contradiction. I'm delivered, my personality. I've been delivered. I've been freed. But my body hasn't been delivered yet. Neither has yours. And since that is a fact, and this is what you deal with when you study Ephesians 4, 22 and 23, and Colossians 3, 5 through 9, or a little further, we're talking, that's really a commentary of what I've just said. So when you think about your taste, after all, folks, our taste gets us in trouble. We eat too much of what we shouldn't eat. I'll tell you something else. Our eyes sometimes get us in trouble. We look at something that we shouldn't look at. Well, let's go a little further. Our anger sometimes gets the best of us. And we're angry where we shouldn't be angry. So you see what I'm talking about. We could go on and illustrate this many, many ways. So the believer himself is delivered, but his body is not delivered. Proof of it, Romans 8, 23, to wit, the redemption of the body. The difference between Christ's body and ours is this. What is the difference? You don't have any trouble making the distinction, do you? I don't. I don't think you do either. Christ was born holy. Luke 1, 35. I was born in sin. Psalm 51 and verse 5. David said, I was conceived in iniquity. So we have to contend with lust, but Christ didn't have to contend with lust. So when people say he could lust, they're bringing Christ down to the level of man, therefore they don't have a Savior. That's what it boils down to. So body is used here in the sense of the physical body. Body of sin. The physical body. Now I'd like for us to consider for a few minutes the fallacy of some other views on the body of sin. Let me list some. Some teach that sin is called a body because it is made up of many members, as the body of an army. Others say the body of sin is sin embodied, meaning the whole mass of sin. Let me give some quotations. Calvin said, the body of sin does not mean flesh and bones, but the whole mass of sin. For man, when left to his own nature, is a mass of sin. Listen to Hodge. Hodge said, the body of sin is only another name for the old man, or rather, for the concrete form. Barnes said, this expression doubtless means the same as that which he had just used, our old man. That's confusion, folks. Barnhouse said, the purpose of our joint crucifixion with Christ by God was in order that the body of sin, which is our old man, might be destroyed. Now let's think about the destruction of this body. Look at verse 6 again. Knowing this, and I don't think that you'll feel like when I do preach on this, I'll try to outline it a little different and explain it more than I'm doing tonight. But I want to show you what all is involved in this study. But when he says, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, in order that the body of sin, King James says, might be destroyed. I'm translating it, may be ineffective. May be ineffective. Now, I'll explain that more when I preach on it, so I won't take time to go into that particular point tonight. So, the ineffectiveness of the body or the destruction of the body of sin means the body of the Christian is no longer a body conditioned and controlled by sin. So it becomes ineffective. It's not controlled by sin. The Christian's body is not controlled by sin, period. He sins, but it's not controlled, not dominated, not an ongoing, continuous thing. All right, let's look at this. Let me give some points on this. If the body of sin means the same as the old nature, then the old nature is made ineffective. Ah, you see what I'm talking about? Now think it through. Folks, it just takes a long time to unravel a lot of these things. It takes a long time. Let me say this again. If the body of sin means the same as the old nature, then the old nature is made ineffective or destroyed. Now, the charismatics would eat that up. We don't sin, we just make mistakes. That's their philosophy. So this is not true. Secondly, the body of the new man is one that is controlled by what has become the ruling principle of his life. Obedience unto righteousness. I want to quote a man on this point. John Murray said in his work on Romans, "The body is an integral part of personality, and since the old man has been crucified, the destruction of the body of sin is an indispensable aspect of that radical transformation of the entire person which the crucifixion of the man connotes." End of quote. So the body of the believer is no longer the place where sin reigns. Sin dwells, but doesn't reign. Does not reign. Present, but doesn't reign. Now, man in Adam, that's the unregenerate man, is controlled by sin, body, soul, and spirit. That's proved in Romans 1, 24 through 28. Man in Christ, that's the new man, the regenerate man, is controlled by the indwelling Holy Spirit of regeneration. Therefore, the believer does not continue to live and wallow in sin. He can't do it. The new man has not died to sin in order to live in it. The new life is a resurrected life. The object of our crucifixion with Christ was to deliver us from the reign of sin over us. I'm just looking at it from different perspectives. The object of our crucifixion with Christ was to deliver us from the reign of sin over us. And finally, in the power of the new nature, the believer overcomes the power of the old nature, not the old man. So the word translated destroyed is kartageo. It does not mean destroy. In Romans 3, 3 and 31, 4 and 14 and 7, 6. Hebrews 2:14. But does mean that it was made ineffective. So the same principle applies to the body of sin. Now, four things must be observed in the destruction or making the body ineffective. Body of sin ineffective. Here they are. Number one, the meritorious cause is the crucifixion of Christ. Secondly, the efficient cause is the indwelling Holy Spirit. Thirdly, the instrumental cause is the truth of Holy Scripture. And we're talking now about progressive sanctification, see? And the word is used in sanctification. Sanctify them through thy word is truth, is what Christ said in John 17, 17. And fourthly, the modal, M-O-D-A-L, modal cause is the infusion of new affections, new principles, and new desires. 2 Corinthians 5:14 for new affections. Principles, Galatians 5:16. Desires, Proverbs 11 and 23. So it is no longer the question of mastery, but the master. Not the question of sanctification, but the sanctifier. Not the question of victory, but the victor. Not the question of a new experience, but a new existence in a new sphere. Folks, I'm living in a new sphere. In a new sphere. Not living in the sphere of sin. Living in the sphere of the Spirit. So the only way for the Christian to deal with sin in the body or flesh is to realize, there is your calculation again, reckoning, counting, is to realize that he is in Christ. That has to be realized first of all. And I think I have a little outline I'll share with you, and we'll develop it later. I like these outlines. I just like to put it all in a few words. Listen to this. Romans 6 presents the believer's threefold relationship. First of all, his relation to Christ. And his relation to Christ by means of information. Information. And we'll get into this. And I'll give you the verses now. 3, 6, and 9. All of this in the 6th chapter. Verses 3, 6, and 9. In verse 3, are you failing to understand? See what I'm talking about? And then in verse 6, knowing this. Knowing this. And look at verse 9. Having known that Christ. So what do we have? I said Romans 6 presents the believer's threefold relationship. Number one, his relation to Christ by means of information. Secondly, his relation to sin by calculation. Reckon. Logizomai, calculation. That's verse 11. So also you consider. Consider is logizomai. Logizomai. And thirdly, his relation to service, and his relation to service is by, you're not going to like this. Oh, yes, you are. Those of you here tonight, you'll like this. By regimentation. Regimentation. You see what I'm talking about? Boy, I'll tell you, you talk about preach, I'll preach. And all of this is in the chapter. That's just one way of about 25 different ways and outlines to look at in this 6th chapter. So I'm going to take my time and cover the most important things. But when you think about information, calculation, and regimentation, that takes it in. And that's the order. We have to know, first of all, we have to know Christ. Then we've got to what? The information must come. And then there has to be the calculation. You've got to reckon. You've got to count. You've got to consider where you are, who you are, where you are. You're in Christ. And you do that by faith. And then regimentation. That's putting everything in order. Putting everything in order. That's the Christian life. Don't forget, God is a God of order. And everything related to God is order, has order in it.